Rock Dudes 27 is presented by Cut SS, which is a company that paints the highest quality knives, custom made to your desire. The knife is not sharp. The blade comes with a rounded off and will not hurt people. At the same time, this butterfly knife is for training and practice. A wide variety of knives and skins are available. We can copy any picture you want, giving you the closest possible replica. Just send us the design of the knife you want and we will do the rest thing for you. For more information, go into cutss.com. Welcome to Rock Dudes 27 and a new international episode. And the guest this time is Elise Reed from the metal band Amaranth. Elise was really meant to be a singer. She actually started to sing before she learned how to talk. During high school, starting to become a dance and performance artist, she met Olof and Jake and they formed a band called Avalanche, which later on was changed to Amaranth. And why they have to change the name? Yeah, you can hear it on Rock Dudes. During this episode, she will also talk a lot about touring with Amaranth and other bands as Camelot, and how it is to be the only girl in the band. We also discussed a lot about her other interests as painting and, creating her own jewelries. She was also talking about her performance in the Swedish contest Melodifestivalen. It's a really interesting episode, and of course she will tell you a lot of anecdotes from the touring and other stuff. You can hear all the stories here on Rock Dudes 27. In the end of the show, we will present a music top list. Together with the guest Elise, we will present 15 songs. And if you are listening to this podcast on Spotify, just get to the playlist for the Rock Dudes 27. And then you can listen both to the interview and then to the music top list stories together with the songs itself. You will find the list on our Spotify profile, rockdudes.se. Now it's time for me to stop talking and we get over to the interview with Elise Reed. Rock Dudes. Welcome to Rock Dudes 27. And today we have a woman here in the house.
Finally, more women to the people.
More Rock women. Dudes.
Ah, there she is.
Yay!
It's Elise Reed from Amaranth.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
And how are you today?
Today I'm very good, thank you. I woke up at 7. I was first day off from the studio for the first time in a while.
Yeah. In Gothenburg? So
we've been recording now for 2 weeks already.
All right, cool.
Together with Jakob Harman. Who I heard is gonna...
He has been a guest here in the last episode before you.
Cool. Actually. So anyways, I thought I was gonna sleep until like 10 or something. I put my alarm at 10, but then I woke up with like panic because I dreamed that my alarm went off and I turned off the alarm and I fell back asleep. So when I actually woke up, I thought it was like 12 or something and that I was late.
To this interview.
Yeah. Or this podcast recording. Yeah. So anyways, I was like, oh yeah, plenty of time. So I thought that I would go to Rock by Sweden.
Yeah.
And pick up some jewelries. So I did that.
What kind of jewelries?
Bracelets, rings.
A lot of bling bings.
Super nice. Yeah, yeah, I love these because they are very glamorous.
What's the name of the brand?
Rock by Sweden.
Rock by Sweden. Cool.
Which is pretty funny since Sweden is a very small country, but we have, music-wise, we have a very big exposure.
Yeah.
So I thought it's fun to find something which is made in Sweden that I can promote a little bit.
So
since we have a camera, it's perfect. I can show you this amazing necklace. I really like jewelries.
So for those who can't see it, it's actually made out of skulls, right?
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yes, skulls, but they're covered with Swarovski stones, mm-hmm. which makes them very like... So it's like glamorous skulls.
Yeah. This is cool. This is the first time we become a fashion podcast from now on.
We're evolving from rock dudes to you will be. That makes sense.
Yeah, but it's rock. It's rock.
It's very rock, but it's still glamorous. So I mean, it's not very common, especially when it comes to like merch and such. That bands actually sell things for women. So that's where I think that I can hopefully make a change.
You're thinking about doing your own jewelry line or for Amarant or yourself?
For myself. For females and hopefully for men too. From my perspective then. Because I like all kinds of art.
Yeah.
Like clothing and jewelries and music of course.
So you're thinking of like a collaboration with another brand or?
That's the idea. Thought I was going to do a collaboration with Rock by Sweden.
Yeah.
When I have time. Because these are things that I like to spend my time on when we're not on tour, for example.
Sure.
Or when we don't have to write a new album, which we've done the past 3 months. So that's one of my plans. And I realized like yesterday, I think, or maybe 2 days ago, that I'm probably going to be an artist for the next 20 years. So I don't feel like very stressed, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
No, I think always very long term.
Yeah.
And these are the kind of things that you can do if you like to do those kind of things.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course. And I thought it would be really fun.
Yeah. Well, are you planning doing it from scratch?
Exactly. Yeah. I was planning to start to skissa.
Yeah. Sketch.
Sketch on my own designs and
cool.
Just find some. I mean, that's also like writing a song. You have to really figure out what's your, like, what can reflect your identity.
Yeah.
And
that's hard though. It's like a little bit, right?
A lot of work.
Yeah, it is. And it's fun though. It's very healthy for the brain to if you are a creative person, you need to stimulate that part of yourself. So this is one of the things that makes me like go deep and you know think. And if I would make a jewelry that represents me, what would it be? Would it be like something towards the animal way or something towards nature, like a leaf or a star? Or a... Also, of course, it takes a lot of time, and time
it's not, is... You don't have that much time.
Not at the moment.
No.
So besides all of this stuff, you're in the midst of recording a new album, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Wow.
Yes, we have... Like I said, we've been there for 2 weeks, and we have already almost finished all the drums. And now Johan is there putting the bass. We're recording the guitars for 2 weeks with Olaf at Top Floor Studios. And then we have some time off because we're starting to play shows again.
Yeah.
And then in 2 months, I'm going to put my vocals on record. Which also means that not all of the lyrics are done yet.
Yeah.
So I have still time to finish them until I put my vocals. Because when I do that, then it has to be...
So how long does it take to do your vocals in the vocal booth? A couple of days or a week?
Usually it takes me 7 days.
7 days? Mm-hmm.
To record 13 songs or 14. I'm very quick. I like to work quick. And also all the choirs.
Yeah.
All the harmonies. Those takes actually
longer.
One or 1.5 days. Yeah. Because it's like the same thing over and over again. 8 times or something.
Yeah.
Because we have 4 stems usually, and then we have to dub them to make it sound like ABBA.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I mean like Amaranth.
So all those 7 days, you do it for the whole week, or you stretch it out for a couple of days just because of your song, vocals, I mean? Is it hard for you to do everything at once?
No, that's the thing. So far, since I'm very trained, I never find it hard. I just find it like anything, like as hard as walking, you know.
Yeah,
but do you think you have to have a day off to just get the right energy, or do you have
no.
that?
No, that's one of the things I was gonna do later. Actually,
yeah.
I'm gonna play you one song, which represents my energy level.
Yeah.
cool. Because I know that we like all people we vibrate on different levels. Energy wise.
Yeah.
And that's why you fit better with certain kind of people.
Yeah.
At least that's what I think. So I think that since I'm always vibrating very fast and high.
Yeah.
I probably suit well together with people who are a little bit more calm, yeah. like in a relationship and such.
Yeah.
I need that balance to not like explode. But when it comes to the stage and recording and such, I mean, I need to be there like all the time, because as soon as I take a break, that's when I start to feel bad. So for me, it's just good to keep on, you know?
On and on and on.
On and on and on.
More ABBA.
Sorry, I was listening all night to
ABBA.
To ABBA.
Yes. Shall we go back a little bit from your childhood or your youth?
Sure.
So just to get a grip on where did the music get into your life?
Music got into my life the minute I was born, probably, because my mother used to be a singer.
Yeah.
My grandfather used to be a jazz guitar player, and my grandmother was a singer too and a ballet dancer. So my mother was on her way to become an artist. She was actually chosen. She went almost all the way to become Pippi Longstocking.
Yeah.
She had red hair and freckles, and she looks like Pippi. My mother, but she got kicked out by this Ingela, eller what is in her? The person that plays Pippi was like number one, so my mother was number two. She almost become Pippi. She was very good at theater and singing and dancing and all that. So I guess that it started already in the stomach, if you know what I mean. And although I'd never met my grandfather, because he died when my mother was 9, but I mean, like, it goes very deep in the history, all this with music. And my father used to play the bass.
Mm-hmm.
He was although only 15 years old when I was born. He just turned 16 actually. Yeah. He was 15 when my older sister came, but so he was very energetic and he played like the bass and listened only to metal.
Yeah.
So I think that the first song I heard when I came out from the stomach was the album with Iron Maiden that was released 3rd of September 1984.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's one of the songs I would like you to play later too.
Mm-hmm.
Is this because that's the first song on that album, and I'm of course I don't remember exactly, but I'm pretty sure that was the first album that my father put on. So it's the...
Your background is basically from your family, musical-wise, because everybody's like artists and musicians. Oh, so
yes.
That's pretty much where you got it from the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. So it was very natural. And my mother sang to me every day. And she said that I started to sing before I started to speak.
So in terms of metal, is that where you got everything from your brother, pretty much? Because your brother was a musician as well, right?
Yes.
Band-wise and...
Yeah, my brother, he's 7 years older than me. He started his first band when he was like 13 or something, I believe.
Yeah.
And he played also only metal.
And he put out records as well, right?
Yes, he put out a couple of records.
Name of the band?
Abandon.
Okay.
But it's like growls and extremely heavy.
Yeah.
So it's one of the things is that it's... extra slow, which makes it even more like
super heavy.
Yeah. He started his first band. I was actually there when I was very small on a gig, and he was part of a band called Relevant Few.
Yeah. Gothenburg band as well. Yes. That's actually grindcore, I think.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Everything comes back to me.
This is really an Amherst cup of
this
tea.
This is like underground, really small stuff, but I haven't listened to these songs or band for like ages.
Yeah.
Mm. Everything comes back to me, so that's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I guess that's what brought me into metal, because also I read the other day somewhere that everything that happens to you the first 3 years of your life is what...
Makes you as a person.
Which is very interesting, because I'm basically living the life now that I did the beginning
back
of my life.
Days, yeah.
Back in the days, yeah, before my parents divorced.
Yeah.
Since I grew up in that family with my brother and my father, the metal
heads.
Heads. And then I discovered, that's why, like, for example, as I mentioned already, ABBA. Well, it's when I heard them, I was like, whoa, what kind of music is this? Everybody sounds so nice. Yeah. And like female voices, which is are like angel voices, you know. Yeah. So I got very affected by hearing those. And I saw Sound of Music. That was the first musical I ever saw. And I saw that movie probably 150 times. And my mother said I was like hypnotized by that movie. And it's also because there were so many cute songs, you know. Yeah. Do a deer, a female deer, right? Da, 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 da.
But it's more like the performance wise that they are dancing and
things. Oh, yeah,
like
and the dancing too. Yeah. Yeah, so that's when I decided that I want to become a musical artist, which I'm educated in. But it's fun because it's the other way around. Usually people be like, yeah, I discovered metal and because it was so different from what I was used to or something. For me, it was the opposite. I was like, I discovered other kinds of.
Music. It's more the opposite way that you listen on pop music and things like that, and then suddenly you just hit by the metal music, and then you just like that. It's more not that common to do the opposite.
And also, of course, when you're a teenager, it's not cool to listen to the same music your parents listen to.
No.
And my mother loved Ozzy Osbourne, and she listened to like Sex Pistols and stuff like that.
So what did the family think of that you listened to pop music?
Oh no, they hated it.
It was
like, no, yes. Normally it's like the other way around.
My mom screamed. Yeah. She was like, turn off that shit music. When I listened to Beyonce, she was like, I'm freaking out, I can't listen, close the door. And my brother, he went through my record collection and he's like, we need to do something about this. We need to save you from the evil.
From the pop evil.
From the shallowness. Nay, I don't know. I just know that people have very strict... people have just a certain way to talk about pop. And also pop people have a certain way to talk about metal.
Yeah.
And I kind of probably realized that...
You love them both.
I love them both, and I don't like the fact that that something like music divides people.
It should bring them together.
Yeah. And that's a little bit what was my force when we started Amaranth, was to
mix those.
Yes, exactly.
Was Amaranth the first band you joined, or did you have another projects before, pop bands or similar?
The first record I recorded was when I was 16, I think, and that was with a band called Falconer.
Oh, that's okay. power metal, actually.
Exactly. Wow. So that was the first like real studio recording and the real job, or you, even though I didn't get paid, but still.
Yeah. You know how was that experience then? Frightening?
It was amazing. No,
it was.
Yeah, I mean. That's the thing, like, because when I'm there, I just felt very home, because, it reminded me of home, you know? And even though my brother thought it was a little bit too happy, or
it's cool to hear that the power metal could be cheesy in kind of way, yeah.
But he was like, oh, but that's cool.
But how did you end up in a song with Falcon? Did you know the band, or?
No, it's, I mean, this is what I love about my life, is that things just happens to me, and I rely very much on faith and destiny and stuff like that. So, well, I was actually just in school, and the singer from the band at that time, he came by the school and asked if they had a student who was a good singer and who they thought could suit on a power metal level. And then my teacher said that they mentioned me, and they said that maybe Elise can do it.
Yeah.
So
did you go on things like a music class or?
Yeah, I went on a musical high school, so that's why he came there probably. Yeah. And the studio was pretty close. And the funniest part of everything is that the guy that recorded me was Andy LaRocque from King Diamond, which is very fun because now we're going to support King Diamond at Espoo Arena this summer in.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. In Finland.
Yeah. Have you ever seen them live, King
Yes,
Diamond?
Yes, we saw them live in New York.
How was that?
It was awesome. It's very fun, actually. It's very much like a musical.
It is.
Yeah.
It's a very theoretical, or what do you say?
So that was actually, yeah, it's very theatrical. Theatrical.
Yeah.
So that was the beginning of all the contacts that I got late, then after that. Because Andy LaRocque knew Jake and Olof. So it's basically through him that I got in contact with them.
Yeah. With Amarante?
No. Amarante didn't exist before.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Me.
Yeah, because they played in other bands.
Yes, they played in... Olof had a band called...
Dragonland.
They still exist, actually. But Jake had a band called Dreamland, who does not exist anymore. But I sing a song together with them on their album, which is called Fade Away. And I also participated at two albums with the Dragonland.
Yeah,
Dragonland. Yeah. So that's how it started. And then I became best friends with Olof. And we started to. He started to help me arrange songs that I wrote, because that was also one of the things that I really wanted to do. And this was before my musical education. I don't remember how young I was, but it's a very long time ago. Anyways, and yeah, I went my first year, I think, on high school, so I was 16,
yeah,
or something, 17. If I don't remember wrong, it's been so many years.
I think the first year in high school is you are 16 or 17.
Yeah, or maybe it was the last year in high school. Everything is just a big mess.
Blur.
Yeah, big blur. Anyways, I became very good friends with him, and we started to write songs together, and not write songs, but he and his co-writer in Dragonland. Oh my God, they're so like. So
yeah.
They helped me to arrange songs that I wrote.
Yeah.
And Olof thought that I had a very good sense of writing songs. So he thought that I should help him write songs for his project called Avalanche.
Yeah.
That he started together with Jake, and they had just like one demo or something. So we said like, maybe we can write something together, and if I put my vocals on the songs just to demonstrate
the melody.
The melodies.
Yeah.
And that's what then later became our demos. And I wasn't even thinking about being part of the band, because I was
doing
my own thing. Yeah. But then when we put them on MySpace, I think it was two or three songs, we got like so good response. People were like, oh my God, what's this? It's so cool. And like with a female voice and the growls, and management got interested in us, and we got even like offers to from record companies.
Yeah.
And then I was like, okay, but what does this mean?
Does it
mean that I have to be here now?
Yeah.
So, and of course they were like, well, I mean, that would probably be good, because this is the product they like. I mean,
mm-hmm.
It would be weird if we just changed. I mean, it would be strange if it wouldn't be us anymore then.
Mm.
So I was like, okay, well, maybe I should just, you know, put my solo plans aside and focus on this instead.
Yeah.
And it wasn't only because we got all these offers and stuff, but it was also because, I mean, of course, it's if you get something served.
Yeah.
If someone put a plate in front of you, why wouldn't you eat from it?
Yeah. That would be very stupid, yeah.
Yeah, that would be very stupid. Why struggle when it can be easy? So, and also because we were such good friends, and I thought it would be so much fun to not do things only, you know, by yourself, but actually experience things and create things with someone else.
And not only because you are put together for some reason.
Oh, yeah, of course not.
Yeah.
No, and I just... Yeah, I had to change
your plans.
My plans a little bit, yeah. And also I thought, it doesn't matter, 1 year here or there.
Yeah.
I can try it out for a year and we can finish the album and we can...
And then you can go on with the education.
Yeah. And then I can go on with my job, actually. I worked in the cabaret at that time.
It took
actually a couple of years. Yeah, it wasn't just like we recorded songs and then like... A couple of months later they contacted us, but they were there for like probably 2 or 3 years actually.
Yeah.
But then it became serious when it spread, because it spread very fast too. Yeah. people were like, listen to this, it's so cool. And people liked very much the demos, and I actually also like the demo of Hunger probably a little bit better than the
finished
the finished version, yeah, because it was very...
Was it more melodic or not so...
I think that...
Or is it just like arrangements?
Playful, probably more playful.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have a plan with it. It was just for fun.
But it is one of your most played songs.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Popular songs, yeah.
Yeah.
And sure. Also it was actually wrong because they mixed my vocals wrong. So the pre-chorus is actually the harmony that's doing the lead on the album. But it was supposed to be the harmony. So the harmonies in the background was supposed to be the lead. But nobody knows that. But people who listen to the first demo we made, they hear that it's different. And a lot of people say that the pre-chorus was better before.
Yeah.
Because that's how actually I wrote it.
Yeah.
But then it went wrong in the mix.
Yeah.
And I noticed that also, like later I was like, no, but it's a harmony that is fronted.
It's too late.
You know, I drop a plan. That was supposed to be the harmony. Yeah. But so the lead would be a drop of blood. It's not a big deal, but you know, but it's still like,
it's more like, a little professions.
Yeah, musicians.
It's still there a little bit fun, actually, that it turned out that way.
Yeah, a little cool that a little mistake just created a hit at that time.
So that was the beginning of, and what I thought was going to be just a tryout for 1 or 2 years became a full-time job.
Yeah.
And now, like 7 years later, 9 years later, I don't even remember. Eight.
I think it's 2008.
That we released
started the band, and 2011
was also very fun because we actually the name was Avalanche. But then, when someone contacted us and said that the name is already taken. So if you earned any money on the name, you owe us 30,000 Swedish kronor.
No way.
And we were like, actually, we haven't made anything on this name, so let's just change it. But they said we could buy it from them, but we were like, no. It was a cover band from up north in Sweden that was called Avalanche. So we were thinking, we already made the logo and everything was ready. So that's when we had to change the name, and we were like discussing back and forth what kind of name it would be. And then it was Olaf actually came up with the idea to call us Amaranth. And we were like, it's not as quick as Avalanche, but maybe it works. And then we started to research like the meaning of the name, and everything felt
on place. Is it just taken, or is it, where is the name come from?
It comes from Avalanche, and we searched, probably he Googled on like similar names or something.
Yeah, similar names.
The same amount of spellings, the same length, and it had to start with an A, because we already had our...
Your logo.
So that's where it comes from. But it has a very beautiful meaning. It means never fading in old Greek. It's also like a name of a seed, which later... I actually eat amaranth seeds for breakfast. It's a beautiful flower with a purple color. So that's why we also, from the name then, we created this more colorful image. Because Avalanche, you know, it would probably have been a little bit more cold and quick.
Wintry
and cold.
Do you remember the other names for ideas? Besides to know what the band could have been named instead?
I know, that's so funny. Oh, I have the sketch at home. I wrote it down on a paper probably.
Does everything start with an A?
Yeah.
That was the idea.
So it's like
Anarchy. Avantasia? No. That's another band.
Then you have those bands that called Avatar and Avatarium. But those all of them names are weren't taken at that time.
Also similar genres as well.
Yeah.
Which is funny. Everything starts with an A.
Gothenburg.
Yeah, pretty much.
Amaranch.
Well, not the Amarone wine.
The name sticks to it. It's a good name. Yeah. Everybody knows it.
I like it too. And it's like, now it feels... so right.
Yeah.
And also I love the fact that it's a little bit...
it's very different.
Womanized.
Yeah.
It's true. Like female. It has some... something that never dies. I like that. Never fades. That's forced us to never grow old, for example. since our name means dad. So now we have to stay young forever. At least we're gonna try, and I mean, of course, I mean, music wise.
Yeah.
That we're not. I promise. No, I can't promise. I can't promise that we're never gonna get old and tired. But usually when we write, we say that always. We don't want to make tired music. Trött musik.
Yeah.
We like that kind of young feeling.
Going slower and slower.
We can't do that. That's why I started to work out, actually.
Yeah.
I have a personal trainer called Sebastian Noring. That's in Eriksberg in Gothenburg. Yeah. I post so many pictures on my Instagram and Facebook now with us working out. And it's only because I felt like I have to do it so that I can jump on stage still. I will have to do that for the following for 20 years.
Yeah, for the next 20 years.
Because I'm not planning on giving up this.
No.
You jump with your high heels?
Mm.
Wow, that's
impressive. I do that, and thanks. That's thanks to the ballet training, though, that I get very strong feet. But I noticed lately that I started to get a little bit pain in my knees and my hips. So that's what my personal trainer is working
with special training for that special exercises.
Exactly, and also to strengthen certain muscles
in the core.
You know this.
Yeah,
because you're training as well.
I've been done core training as well.
That's a bit different because Elise is actually on stage. It's like a workout pass.
But
1 hour.
It's like for the athletes. You have to do the training before the season is coming. You have to,
What kind of sports did you do?
No, I just do normal stuff.
body pass.
Yeah.
What is called?
Workout and with weights and things like that. And just running. So it's normal training. Not with a personal trainer, though.
No. I can really recommend that, actually.
Yeah, I think
but
so.
You need
because
to find
they
a good
push.
One.
Yeah, they push them in a good way to push you forward. In the training.
Exactly, but the funny part is that I actually haven't even started to lift any weights yet.
No.
Because I'm still working on relaxing.
Yeah, but today is there is an exercise called CrossFitness. That's more not using weights. You're using your
that's
own.
That's exactly the thing I'm going to work with.
Yeah, you're using your own body more.
And that's the thing he teach me now how to use these equipments so that I also can bring them on tour.
Yeah.
Because it's very easy. That was also part of the plan to adapt the workout for
touring
for touring
so you don't have to use another bus to get the equipment with
exactly.
you
exactly yeah that would be impossible you know to bring like a löpband or
all
to
these
bring weights and stuff.
Those worse no yeah but
workout.
All,
no, that
all these
be
kinds
impossible.
Of equipment
yeah. So I think that's going to be...
That's a good way.
I hope it's going to be good. And of course, I don't work out to be a fitness model or something. I work out just to not get pain from... And so that I can have maximum energy on stage.
Yeah. That's cool.
Besides Amarante and Falcone, you also done a couple more session work, for example, Camelot, right?
Exactly. Yes.
So is that the same thing? Someone asked you at the school, look, can you do more vocals? Or how did that come about?
They found me on MySpace too, actually. Like, everything starts with MySpace. So thank you, MySpace.
Yeah, it was really great back in the days. Today
and
you
now
have Facebook or
gone,
YouTube.
Kind of.
Yeah.
It's big in the States, but over here it's like nobody cares, pretty much.
No, anyway, so he that's how he do, actually... Since I'm very good friends with Thomas Youngblood these days, he's like an extra father to me. He's very sneaky. No, but he goes to social media and YouTube and search for people there. That's how we found Tommy Karvik.
Okay.
Yeah, because I can see him. He's like, I was like, what are you up to? You know,
he's
like
into a detective.
His computer. Yeah, like a detective. Yeah, detective. Detective Thomas. He was like, I'm looking for a good singer. Like, okay. So he's really good at that.
Yeah.
That's how he found Elisa too, even though she wasn't so hard to find.
So you tour with them from time to time, right? Or don't you? Or with Camelot?
I still do, actually. When I have spare time.
How does that work though? I mean, they're going on a tour and you jump in as a backing vocal.
Yeah, now now I only do guest performance.
Guest performance.
I perform the song. Yeah, this is the thing actually, that Simone was their extra singer. And she toured with them, but then Epica became too busy, so she couldn't tour with them anymore. So that's when they started to get in contact with you.
Yeah.
So that's when they contacted me. And since both Olaf and Jake are super big Camelot fans, they were like freaking out. And they said to me, they like, you have no idea who just, what kind of what kind of question you just got. And I was like, Camelot, never heard of them, I don't know. But then I started to search myself then on YouTube, and I saw this The Haunting, and I saw Simone, and she became a big inspiration to me, and I was super nervous, but that was one of the happiest days of my life, because I realized that I was fulfilling one of my biggest dreams, to tour, see the world.
Was it the first touring experience?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, okay.
So they taught me everything, and they taught me everything about touring and all that, which is actually a little bit weird, because I mean, the natural way would be that I experienced all this with my own band, but I think it was a very good start, because I could also on the same time do a lot of promotion for my band while I went to all these places.
Yeah.
So it's Did
you get the interviews and things like that? Or, yeah, okay.
And the people were asking, like, do you have your own band? And yeah. I was like, yes, I have. It's called Amaranth.
And now Amaranth is bigger than Camelot. How does that, in comparison with everything, it's a bit weird, right?
Yeah, I mean, in some places they still have a bigger audience, like around Europe and probably Australia, because we've never been there.
Uh-huh.
But in the States, it's like, it feels... it feels awesome. But what is good is probably that I also realize what kind of level we actually grow to. Because if you're not used to that, and maybe you have another view on things, if you just imagine.
Yeah, if you just go on the tour and just you don't have the time to rethink of what you have experienced during the tour, and then when you come home, maybe you see how many people have been at the shows and how many fans have grown.
And you get a perspective.
Yeah, perspective.
Since they existed for
many years.
I don't even want to guess a number, but I know it's very long.
Yeah.
And they were on a certain kind of level in US, for example. And then when we come with Amaranth, we play the same venues, and then it makes me realize how quick we grew, like how fast everything. So I'm very grateful. Like I said, it was the first tour I did, a European tour, and then of course we discussed like if I should continue or if they would try to find someone else. But since we were not so busy with Amaranth, it became my full-time job to tour with Camelot. So I did like 5 tours or 6 with Camelot.
That's a lot.
On a whole tour for 1 month in Europe. And I was so excited. I couldn't even sleep because I didn't want to miss anything. So I was sitting in the front with a bus driver and watching the road. And I did sightseeing almost every day. And in the end, I got super sick because I didn't have any energy, I didn't sleep enough, and I didn't eat enough, because that's like also one thing you don't know before going on tour. You don't really, it's very hard to adjust, and it's a lot of new air and bacteria. So
yeah, stuff. Living on the bus.
You're not used to American germs. I wasn't used to that. No, but it was just so much going on, so I was really sick the first tours. But I could still perform, I could still sing, except for probably 3 times or something, I lost my voice. But and then it was just fantastic, and I did the festival summer with them too. We played at Rock and Ring and Rock and Park. That's one of the festivals we haven't played yet with Amaranth, which I really wish we could go back to.
Yeah.
Because that was amazing. And We went to the US. We supported Nightwish. And also, of course, in the middle of all this, Roy Khan quit. So we actually were supposed to do a US tour that got cancelled. And that one was... Oh, it was very big. It was huge venues. And so they called me 1 week before the tour was supposed to start and said that, sorry, it's not going to be a tour. And I was like, no. I was so sad. Of course, they were more sad than me, but I was devastated. So I went anyways. We went to Disney World and all that. Disneyland.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But anyways, I was just like, okay, I have to make sure I come to the US one day.
Yeah.
So that's when I started to think that we have to make it with Amaranth so I can do that US tour, because I really wanted to tour US. But anyways, then it went very well for Camelot, because Tommy was doing such a good job and the fans stayed and they accepted him very well. And so that's when we then, I think it was 1 or 2 years later, we did that US tour. And that was the first time I was in the US. And I loved it. And we went to on a South American tour. And that's pretty cool, actually, because we supported Iron Maiden in Argentina. Okay. In front of like 40,000 or 50,000 people.
Shit, that's big.
Yeah, that's super big. And since I, like I said before, probably Iron Maiden was the band I heard
most of.
It was a pretty surrealistic thing to be on stage right before them, supporting them. But so I experienced a lot. I got super sick, like always, and we didn't sleep. Everybody looked like dead.
Grayer and grayer.
Yeah, everybody got gray.
Yeah.
And everybody looked so old. But then we got one day off. We went to, I think it was in Brazil. Okay. We had one day everybody could sleep. Because I couldn't sleep because there were like cockroaches in the jars. And,
oh.
You know, I wasn't so used to that things. I was a little bit silly. I was standing in the corridor like for many hours waiting for someone to come and help me get off them. I didn't want to, you know, I wanted someone to take them out so I could sleep. So I got like, that was so tough.
Have you thought about touring together though with Amaranth and Camelot?
We have.
You have? Okay.
Yes.
When was that?
I don't know, 2011 or 12.
Oh, that was the time ago. Oh, that's
cool. Yeah, it was one of our first bigger tour.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, that's also one of the good things was that we got really great bands to support, like Camelot. And I did double shows then.
You did?
Yeah. First we opened up and then I changed clothes and went on stage again.
How was that though? Confusing for the fans or different?
No. I had a mask on and I did most backup vocals at that time. So I was I switched roles.
Yeah. So they didn't really know that it was.
Yeah. Some people thought it was like three different girls on stage.
Yeah, okay.
But when nowadays though, since Amaranth is busy and you're busy, who's the replacement for Camelot or?
Yeah, that's the interesting thing, because then after a while, a couple of years, probably four, that I toured with Camelot constantly.
Yeah.
We got more and more shows with Amaranth, and I got more and more busy, so it got harder and harder to. to
combine those two.
Yeah, combine. Yeah. So I had to make it. I had to say no to for a while.
Yeah.
And that's when they took in Alyssa Whiteglass. But she came actually already. So she's doing my vocals now. No, actually, then. Oh, I'm sorry. It's so many things. And she got chosen by Arch Enemy.
Yeah.
So when she also couldn't then tour so much with Camelot, now they have Cobra from Cobra and the Lotus.
Seems that all of the female vocalists gets their own career sooner or later after joining Camelot.
I kind of feel that too. I mean, that's the sneaky Thomas. He's very good. He's like a secret agent.
He searched for the talents and then they create...
Yes.
Bigness and that can
it's a very good school.
Yeah,
also.
It's a good school. Yeah,
it's a planting school, and then leads up to something else.
Camelot.
That's a good news. Camelot as a plant school.
Yeah.
So besides Camelot, you also been on the Schlager. How do you say it?
Schlager Festival. Melodifestivalen.
Yeah. European Schlager, Eurovision contest or whatever.
He's the second guest here in the podcast that has done that, because Nicky Borg.
That was a bit experience for him as well.
Yeah.
But so, you know, it's like a poison for Swedish people.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, this Melodifestival. Yeah. It's like...
Everyone talks about it. Yeah.
It's like a big demon crawls under your skin. And
it's like the biggest...
Force you to strive to...
Either you love it or you hate it. And but the thing is, either you love it or hate it, you talk about it.
Yeah, yeah.
Either a good way in a bad way.
But I mean, it has changed. It's more and more actually metal rock band is joining.
Eclipse was
just recently,
year,
right?
Yeah.
And obviously went good for them. I mean, kind of, right?
Yeah, it's a good marketing thing.
It is.
Yeah.
So, Elis, tell me a little about your experience then.
Sure. Yeah. You're right. It's a good window.
Yeah.
As they call it. But for me, it was about also one of my biggest dreams. Because I always watched it when I was little kid. And it's just been something you look up to a lot.
Yeah.
So I just felt like...
Now or never?
Yes.
How did you get the chance?
I started to co-write with people who writes a lot of songs for Melodifestivalen. Some very big names and some... less big. So the one that I actually got attended with was Jimmy Jansson.
Okay.
So he and I wrote the song. And then we got some help from Kjell Ola and a girl called Sharon. That's how it
started.
So it started with the song.
Yeah.
And it started with me asking my publishing, Warner Chappell, if they had songwriters I could work with. And then Niklas Rune is a very good contact for me from Universal Sweden and Capitol. He's working for Capitol now.
Yeah.
But he said that I should see Jimmy Jansson and try to write with him. Because it's very interesting, you know, like it depends on what kind of person you meet.
Yeah.
It creates...
Different
things.
Yeah.
So, yeah. We spent only a couple of hours, actually, in the studio. And this song happened, which is called One by One. And at that time, of course, I didn't know that the song was going to get chosen, because that's a very long process. They have to send it to this jury, and the jury have to... I think they have 2,500 songs to listen to.
At least, yeah.
At least, yeah. And they liked it, so they picked it out. But it was also probably a big reason why it got chosen was probably because Rickard Söderberg sings with me.
Yeah,
and the idea with that was because the song was very bombastic.
Yeah,
and we both talked about that it would be cool to have some kind of opera voice in the chorus. Either like backing vocals, you know, like a big opera choir.
Yeah.
And see, he asked me then if I knew some opera singer. And I was like, yes, I know Rickard Söderberg. Because I met Rickard Söderberg while I was recording Så ska det låta. Which is an entertaining
music,
Swedish music
show.
Game show.
Yeah.
So that's when I started to meet that's when I started to know him. So I was friends with him on Facebook. So I just wrote directly from the studio, like a text, like, "Hi, I think I have a song that you might like. Are you interested in joining or collaborating on that one?" And he just answered like, "Yes. When do you want me there?" So I flew down to Stockholm from Malmö to Stockholm like the next week. And he put his vocals on it. But since he is a big star in Sweden, it wouldn't make sense if he just did backup vocals or sang along in the choir.
Yeah.
So we tried different ways to share the song to make it even. And the results were, as you can find on iTunes, YouTube and everywhere.
Yeah,
it's history.
But I mean, the experience was only, like for me... it was fantastic to finally do something you've been thinking about for 25 years, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
So I'm very happy now that I get the chance to do that. And also I feel a little bit revealed, because now I don't have to, you know,
think
stress
that.
About
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Or, because now I know what it's like.
Yeah.
It's very fulfilling to make dreams come true.
Yeah.
Do you miss it? You want to go back? Do something
no,
more?
No, I don't. I feel like I definitely want to focus on Amaranth and tour the world, because honestly, I think I'm a better artist overseas than I'm here in Sweden.
That might change though in the future.
Yeah, I mean, I would actually say yes if I got the opportunity to participate again, because it was such a cool experience to have your own number, and we also did everything ourselves. Maybe next time I'm going to be alone if I get the chance, because then I can create the number and everything. Like every artist do that. Someone has a maybe a manager or something who helps them to come up with the ideas, but it was up to us to decide everything.
You can do more or less whatever you want.
Exactly, that's yeah. the thing, and you have unlimited budget, kind of, almost. Mm-hmm. And the biggest stage you can find, and the best audience is like 4 million people watching.
Yeah, yeah. Network and, as well.
Yeah, and the like the light is perfect, the sound is perfect, everything is perfect. So it can't get any better, almost.
No.
And that's very tempting, because next time if I get the chance, I already have a plan how I would like to do my number.
You might even sing in Swedish, who knows?
If you compete again, though, of course I would like to make it to Eurovision.
Yeah,
yeah, but that could work.
Because you get very competitive. I didn't think I was a competitive kind of person, but I realized that I am.
In that kind
and
of environment.
And I don't like
environment.
To compete, because I... Yeah. Oh, it feels awful to not lose, because it was a... I didn't lose because I got picked out from so many. I mean, I was one of the.
Everyone is a winner from the start.
Yeah, from the start you're yeah. already a winner. But then, of course, when you're there and people vote for you, of course you get a little bit like, oh.
No,
I think we could have went further. This is a little bit inside information. I mean, you know, they had this app, and
yeah.
It was very new for a lot of people. It was actually completely new. It was the first show ever they used the app. And they presented the app in the beginning of the show, and they just said to people like, yeah, you can download it, and then you just push the app and it's free, and blah blah blah. So people forgot to call, or they didn't call, they tried to download the app. So the first number got not so many votes, and the second number got a little bit more, and the third got a little bit more, and then till the end, and the last number got most votes. So it was the last number who kicked out our number.
Mm-hmm.
Because she had more app votes, but we had second most phone votes. So people still liked our song
yeah.
and our number apparently. So if it wasn't because of the app, you never know.
Actually. It's a technical issue that sucks. I mean,
it's a technical issue,
and today you have to be working on all the platforms.
The shit is rigged.
Yeah,
I told you.
Yeah,
but if
you're big on social medias, I think you can gain a lot of votes for that as well.
Of course, yes. Of course, yeah, that's the thing. If you're a blogger and you compete in Let's Dance, you can win the shit.
Yeah.
apparently, yeah. There goes.
I mean, it's a talent as well to be big on social media.
Yeah.
Do you do appearance on TV as well for something different as you as a musician? Not singing-wise, I mean, game shows or whatever.
If I've done that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Besides, Så ska det låta?
Fångarna på fortet.
Oh, yeah, I haven't been there yet, but I think that's something I would like to do. I know I want to do that. That's also why I go to the gym now, so that if I can do it maybe next year or the year after that, I'm not going to make a fool out of myself.
So for us, for the non-Swedish listener, Fångarna på fortet is basically a castle somewhere?
It's a castle down in France. Somewhere and
we compete, right?
Yeah, you do a lot of odd stuff like picking up keys from snakes and spiders and.
So in the end, it's like a treasure chest. You have to gather everything to get in.
Yeah, to get into the money. So yeah, it's
so it's everything from actors to musicians to famous people entering.
Yeah, and the castle. It's a show that has been for over 20 years.
Ah,
wow, still going strong, right?
Yeah, I think they have they ended it for some years and then they pick it up again. So it's pretty
that
big.
Not that big
in the 90s, I think. But
if people is listening, Elias, want to join?
Oh yeah, exactly.
Climbing please. The mountains. Or
I mean,
whatever.
And in that case, you have to watch and you can laugh if you want.
Yeah.
Because you know, I scream a lot.
You do.
Yeah.
Phobias for
when I get scared or if I get pushed, like in pushy situations.
Yeah. My throat
opens up and I just scream like super loud. So straight out.
But what are you scared of? Like spiders or rats or?
You told us about cockroaches
yeah.
In the hotel. Was it the scene there with a lot of screaming?
I didn't scream. Nah. No, I mean when I compete, if I play a like video game or something.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I okay. just like. I can't do it now because you would.
So you're not really afraid of anything then?
No.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I'm afraid of cars.
Cars?
Cars?
In what way?
I think they're like... Trucks are the worst. They're like monsters. I'm scared of traffic.
Monster trucks in
so
the
that's
US.
Why I don't have a driving license.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Because I think I'm gonna die in a car crash if I get that.
That makes Ouch. Sense.
So that's the only thing I'm scared of.
So how is it to travel with buses all
yeah,
around the world?
Yeah, that's the thing. I have a lot of dödsångest.
Yeah, anxiety.
Ouch.
I had that a lot. Yeah. So I started to drink wine, and I thought it was going to get better, but it didn't, so now I'm back to normal again.
Red wine.
Red wine.
Yeah, red wine, I was like, but, I mean, it could be a good way to become an alcoholic, but I just felt like everything started to fall apart.
Yeah, that's...
I got, like, tired, a little bit chubby, like my... voice started to sound
like a
whiskey voice and it doesn't
fit.
I was
you
like, it's not worth it, so if something happens on the road, it's gonna happen anyways.
Yeah,
so I'm just gonna try to live every day like it's the last.
It's
and take care of myself and be healthy, eat healthy and work out and do some stuff like that. I actually feel so much better living that kind of life than the regular rock life, you know, the classic rock metal lifestyle is that you drink every day and you
you do your shows and after that it's always after parties.
Yeah, I mean it's that kind of environment.
Yeah.
It's free.
Yeah.
For God's sakes.
Well, what's the future plans for Avanta after recording? I'm guessing it's a touring cycle again, right? 1 year here.
Exactly. Same round, over and over. Hopefully we can make a little... Vet du den? Avstickare.
Yeah.
Detour?
Ooh. Yeah, to Australia, because we've never been there. Somehow, it just seems like we don't get there.
How come? There's no...
I don't know.
It's harder, or...?
It's probably because the audience isn't that big yet.
Okay.
I would guess.
But you've been to Asia, right, with the band in Japan?
We've been to Japan many times.
Yeah. Korea as well?
No, never Korea, never Japan, never China. So that's the territories we still have left to conquer. Yeah.
But have you been in South America? No? With Amaranth?
We've only been to Mexico.
Yeah, okay, Mexico.
Oh. So of course that would also be one of the plans to go there. But it's very far.
It's pretty tricky to
it's
do
very
this,
expensive.
South America.
Yeah, we probably need to wait till we are on a bigger... I mean, I could go on a tour if we could do this kind of tour we did with Camelot. But we're not there yet.
Yeah. So what's the best experience fan-wise? Which countries? Australia? No.
That's always a tricky question.
Depends
but
on...
But you know
what?
I cannot favorize audiences. Because some audiences
equal.
Are a little bit... Nah, I love our audience everywhere.
That's cool.
But
can you tell us a little more if is it different between countries in Europe?
Of course it is.
Yeah.
It's very hard because I could say, yeah, maybe German audiences are a little bit more laid back, but then you come to a city in Germany where they are like the craziest ones you've ever seen. So
yes,
it's very individual.
Yeah.
And my theory is that our music brings a certain kind of people to the show and everybody has a lot of energy. So it never gets boring. Of course, I feel sorry for those who maybe show up in a show somewhere in a country, in the countryside outside of London or, you know, somewhere in England and there is not so many people. Then it's, of course, very hard to be pushy, loud. And so it makes it hard for them. But if it would be a full venue, it's usually amazing.
Yeah.
They, it's something, I guess, that the music...
Is it a lot of sing-alongs that the audience sings with you?
Everybody sings along on Amaranth.
Yeah.
Hunger, of course.
And that's the boring thing is that I use in-ears, and so I can't always hear the audience.
No.
I hate that. But if I don't use the in-ears, I actually started to get a little bit deaf. I mean, my hearing is very sensitive.
Yeah.
So it's very hard for me to be in like a restaurant or something where people talk loud.
It's very hard for production-wise to bring in the audience in the in-ears because the biggest bands has the audience in their ears.
That's what we're gonna start with as soon as we get the chance. That's one of that's the next thing we have to fix that because we really want to hear the audience.
Yeah.
I actually always take out my headphone, but it also looks super, I don't know, it just looks so boring when you all the time have to like
in and out.
Pick your ear.
Yeah.
So that would be really nice.
Yeah.
You need the audience to do a good job.
Yeah, that's what you get the energy from.
Yeah, we get energy from the audience and hopefully the audience gets the energy then from back through the music. So it's definitely give and take. Every show is give and take.
Do you have any special anecdotes from the road? The special things that the fans do?
Yeah, well, one thing that is very hard to forget is we have a fan club in Russia. And there are a lot of people, like young people, and they, for every show, they surprise us during Amaranth. So the first time we went, everybody started to blow soap bubbles at the same time. So it was just like in a dream.
Yeah, like a fairy tale.
I was like, you know, you get so touched by those kind of actions they do. And then the others, the second time, they brought up flowers. Like everybody had one red rose in the hand, and they just like at the same time put them up during Amaranth, and it looked so beautiful from the stage. It was amazing. And then the last time we played, they brought up one word from the lyrics on a paper at the same time during Amaranth. And we're going back now in October.
Yeah, okay.
And it's going to be interesting to see what kind of idea they come up with this time.
That's cool.
But it's cute because there is, like, fan clubs are very, I mean, we appreciate them a lot. And that's where they can connect. And I love that.
Yeah.
And the thing with fan clubs are just very cute. And it's fun for them if they like the same band and they can, you know, discuss and plan. And so the fan club there is apparently very connected.
Yeah.
So they're growing strong and they come up with great ideas and we really appreciate that. So create more fan clubs. That's super fun.
Rock Dudes. Now it's time for Rock Dudes 27's music top list. Together with the guest Elise, we will present you 15 songs. If you're listening to this podcast through Spotify, go to our profile rockdudes.se and to this episode's playlist. Then you can hear all the good stories together with the songs itself. Rock Dudes. Now it's time for the music top list and we start with Elise. And what's your first song?
Okay, my first song is going to be Iron Maiden, Aces High. From the album
Power Slave.
Yeah, because it was released 3rd of September and I was born 15th of October, which makes it extremely natural that my father played this album when I came home from BB. So this, I can almost guarantee to 99.9% that this is the first song I ever heard. This song is actually my favorite song, so it maybe makes sense. Since it was the first song I ever heard, it's my favorite song with Iron Maiden.
And number two.
Number two, this song is called The Ride, and it's with one of my absolute favorite groups, which is called Basic Element, and they're from Sweden.
Yeah.
And I bought all their albums. It's crazy music, and why I would like everyone to listen to this song is because it represents the level of energy I feel. I feel like this song vibrates on my level.
And the third song, what would that be?
The third song should be a song from my brother. The band is called Abandon, and the song is called Pitch Black Hole.
Yes, and now to the fourth song.
The fourth song I would like you to listen to, because I remember it like yesterday. I choreographed a dance routine to this song, because when I heard this song, I got very inspired. I just wanted to dance, and it's called Bang Bang, and it's the version of Cher.
Okay. And the last song on this list, what would it be?
Well, it was very hard for me to pick only five songs, because there are many songs that have formed and inspired me. And I mean, I have role models like Madonna and Bonnie Tyler, and ABBA is probably the biggest inspiration vocal-wise, so I would like to play an ABBA song, but everybody heard ABBA, so it's not... you know how ABBA sounds like.
Yeah.
And if you don't know it, you can just go to Spotify or iTunes and listen. But one song that I really like from ABBA is Chiquita, and Voulez-vous, and... There are just too many, so it's really hard to pick one. So that's why I decided to go forward to my second biggest inspiration vocally. And that's Freddie Mercury from Queen. Because to me, he's the world's best singer. And I haven't heard any singer who got me the way he did. And it was also thanks to my brother that I discovered Queen, because he bought me a lot of cassettes. He bought me cassettes with Metallica also, actually. Yeah. And my favorite song from that cassette was Nothing Else Matters, and everybody heard that song also probably.
Yeah.
So that's why I thought it's a little bit interesting to listen to one of the first song I loved with Queen. And it's not a very common song, I guess. I know it's not one of the most played songs, and it's Innuendo.
Okay.
So here it is.
Jonas, your top five for this episode is, well, it's containing a lot of Swedish bands actually, but the first one is a band that's been going on strong for a couple years now. Well, several years.
Yeah, it's one of the Gothenburg power metal band, or what do you will call it? In some gothic power
Evergreen!
Metal.
Evergreen!
Yay! So I will start with that one, and I have chosen the song King of Errors from the latest album Hymns for the Broken. Yeah, it's a pretty typical Evergreen tune, and yeah, it's a mid-tempo song, and it's heavy wall of guitars and powerful chorus. Yeah, it's pretty dark, as usual, and yeah, it suits well with the arrangement, so...
And the next song is actually a song that I... Well, not the song I chose, but from the same band.
Yeah.
small genre, this gothic metal power scene.
Yeah, you talked about the Swedish band, but this is quite a Swedish band with a Swedish singer. And we're talking about Camelot. Yeah, and I have chosen a song from the latest album from last year called Haven, and the song is Insomnia. Oh, I'm not really the biggest fan of Camelot, but the chorus is this one. It should be a sing-along live, so I just chosen this one for that reason.
The third band is, well, maybe the Finnish biggest export music up to date.
Yeah, I think so. It's Nightwish. And the Finnish master of gothic and symphonic metal. That did the latest released last year. And it's called Endless Forms Most Beautiful. And there have you, they have the new female vocalist, Flora Jensen, since 3 years ago. And this one was the first record for her. There are many great tracks on this album, but I've chosen The Weak Fantasy, which is a dynamic song built up on heavy riffs and massive keyboard arrangements. And Flora Jensen has a really powerful and dynamic voice. It will be really great to see them live on Bråvalla this summer.
And we're in Italy.
Yeah, this band, I think you chosen this one from the Furious?
Yeah, seems like we have similar taste in music, you and me both.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. This Italian goth band Lacuna Coil have been around the block for, is it 20 years?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. And they have a great success, and I've chosen one of the new singles, Delirium. It's a classic gothic sounding song where the combination between the two singers, Andrea Ferro and Christina Scabbia, shows off really well.
Last but not least, why not end it with a song from Elise?
The last song for me in this list would be the most massive track from our guest Elise Reed's band Amaranth's latest album Massive Addictive. I really like the massively heavy riffs from Olof Mørk's guitars and the great dynamics between the three singers Jake, Elise and Henrik. I'm also really fond of well-done guitar solos, and on this album Olof has shown a whole another level. It's not too long, it's just perfect, and just adding something great to the song, Massive Addictive. Okay, now it's your five songs, Amir. Which one is the first one?
Well, I found some music from Holland, actually. This is the earliest band from Holland regarding doing this kind of music, The Gathering. I picked an actual live album, The Big Sleep Superheat is the song, and it's from the live album, Symphonic Metal. Well, it's kind of dark, poppy sound.
Okay.
It's been around for ages. I don't think they're active anymore, or kind of, but you should definitely check it out, for sure.
That was The Gathering from Holland. So, what's up for number two?
Camelot. I picked the song Liar Liar from the Wasteland Moniker album. This song is actually featuring Alice White from Arch Enemy. It's a bit different because you can hear not really her typical sound. It's kind of adds a different flavor to the song. So I didn't pick a song with Elise with Camelot this time, but should definitely check this out though.
So that was Camelot again, but you have chosen totally different one for the third one.
We're back in Holland. It seems like Holland delivers and delivers. They even had Within Temptation, but I didn't pick them. I picked another band, actually, After Forever, with the song Monolith of Doubt from Decipher, the album, The Sessions. Actually, Flora Jensen, that you mentioned before, this was her band early on after they quit and she moved over to Nightwish as their current singer. So you should definitely check out After Forever.
Now it's only two songs left. And are you going to choose anything you work with yourself?
You guessed right. Actually, I'm working with the Norwegian artist Kai Røslutten. And I picked the song Why So Lonely from the album Time to Tell, featuring Thomas Holopainen, the keyboard player from Nightwish. Actually, Kari is a Norwegian soprano singer from the beginning. And she was the former lead singer and songwriter for the now disbanded band Norwegian Doom Metal, The Third and Immortal. And actually, if it wasn't for this band, Nightwish wouldn't exist. So they were really early on with this kind of gothic scene movement with female vocals and metal in the background. So, yeah.
Okay, now it's time for the last song. And how was it? Did you have any more bands that was the same as on my list?
Yeah, there's not many bands from Italy doing that kind of music. Again, Lacuna Coil, but this time I picked a song they actually sing in Italian, Senza Fine. I don't know what that means, but sounds nice. From the album Unleash Memories. And again, this is Italian's biggest export band, so...
Now it's time to end this show, and
bittersweet.
Bittersweet, yes.
No, we had a great show. We learned a lot with Elise and all of the million bands she's been participating with.
Yeah, she's still young, but have been experienced a lot.
Still going strong.
Yeah.
So, Elise, thanks for
coming to our podcast.
Thank you for bringing me. It was very fun to speak to you.
Rock Dudes. Thank you for listening to Rock Dudes 27, where our guest Elise Reed from Amaranth did tell us all about her experiences and all the stories about touring and more. The music top list that was in the end of the show will be published through our Spotify profile and homepage rockdudes.se. Don't forget to follow us on our social media network as Facebook, Instagram, YouTube and Twitter. Search for Rock Dudes Podden. Please write some comments about this episode or what you're thinking about this podcast. And of course, which guest you want to be in our future episode of Rock Dudes. We will of course thank our sponsor Cat SS. Go to catss.com for more information. The jingle was recorded by Jonas Hermansson, Peter Månsson and Mia Colehart from Crucified Barbara. The interview was recorded by me, Jonas Love, and was edited by Andy Gold. Next episode, Rock Dudes 28, will be published the 3rd of June. Until then, rock on!